In today's class, we're going to be making this bracelet, and we're going to be using all kinds of different texture hammers. We're going to be using commercially bought texture hammers, found texture hammers from flea markets, hardware stores, and then professional jewelers hammers to add texture to our metals. Texture to a metal really adds your individuality. It adds interest, shape, design. Texturing is really what makes the metals stand out from the other mediums that you can use in the jewelry industry. All right, let's pull out the hammers and get this game going. Okay, some of the tools we're going to use in today's project are, you're going to need a surface to texture on. This can be a bench block. It can be antique irons, it can be an anvil, any type of hard metal surface that you can texture on, all right? You're gonna need a ruler and a marker. You're gonna need a pair of shears, and you're going to need possibly a soft blow hammer also. And then I like working on my protective work surface. This is a noise absorbing, self-healing, heat resistant rubber mat that I like to work on. Here are a few of the tools you're going to use, your hand tools. This is a 1.8 millimeter hand punch. It will make a 1.8 millimeter hole in your metal. We're going to be using 24 gauge, and it's quite safe to use this one. This is a two hole punch, which we would be using the silver side here, which is also a 1.8 millimeter size hole. And then we're going to use a spring-loaded punch. We're going to use a 1/8 inch drill bit, which is in a pin vise. We're going to use a number 2 jeweler's file, and we're going to use a coarse sanding sponge. Here's some more of the hand tools we're going to be using today. This is a bracelet bending plier to shape our bracelet. This is the medium wrap and tap in which we're going to make jump rings. This is a chain nose plier and a bent nose plier in which we're going to put our bracelet together and harden our jump rings with. And then this is just your everyday ordinary clothespin, which you're gonna have to hang on to see what special thing we're gonna do with that. These are the tools in which we're going to use to make our jump rings to attach our bracelet together with. We're going to use a jeweler saw with a 2/0 blade. We're gonna use a lubricant. We're going to use a flush cutter. We're going to use a sawing jig, which I will explain to you what it's for and how to make one for yourself. This is an optional tool that I use today. This is a disc cutter. We're going to use the disc cutter along with the 1/2 inch cutting disc and a 2-pound brass mallet to make the hole for our toggle clasp. These are the supplies that I'll be using to add a patina to our finished product. I have the liver of sulfur liquid form and the steel wool. This is 4/0 steel wool. If you're looking for it to buy, this is a brand that's very nice and easy to get, and you look for 4/0000 steel wool. These are the materials we're going to use for our project today. We're going to use 24 gauge copper sheet. This is 1 1/4 by 6 inches, and we're going to use approximately 2 feet of 16 gauge copper wire. All right, let's discuss the hammer options that you have for texturing to begin with. These are commercial made texture hammers that you can purchase, easily obtainable, reasonably priced. They work well. There are a few misconceptions, of course, about texture hammers, which you're going to really see more during the demonstration than you will right now. But these are hammers that you can order, and each one, these first three, have 2 heads per hammer that will give you a texture. Okay, you have this one, and then this kind of a salt and pepper shaker. Then this one has a checkerboard, and then another straight line, a little bit thicker than the other one. And then this one is really unique here. It has 2 heads here, but these heads come apart, and you can change the pieces. And so you are virtually getting 9 different hammers in one piece. And it really does, it's a nice little hammer. It does a nice little texture. So these are easily obtained. You don't have to go out and search for different types of hammers. They're right there at the push of a button or at a phone call. So we're going to use these today. And these are your commercial hammers. This is one of the commercial hammers that you can purchase, and I wanted to just show you, point out a few things about texture hammers in general, using this one as the example. On this side, it has this kind of checkerboard, herringbone looking design, and over here it has these really neat little snowflake flower designs. Now, when you purchase a texture hammer and you have just fallen in love with the design on the head, you have to remember that when you hammer down on the metal, you are not going to get 4 perfect little stars hammered out on your metal. You're going to get bits and pieces of each of these lines, and generally this area right here is going to be the dominant pattern that's going to show up on your metal. If you love this star pattern and you want a perfect star pattern on your metal, you are much better off to buy a design stamp in which you hold and strike with a hammer that gives you that particular stamp into your metal than you are to use a texture hammer, because you're just not going to get this entire design when you're hammering on metal. Okay, these hammers are, these are frets hammers. These are professional hammers. Each one has an individually shaped head, and the shape of the head determines the direction in which your metal is going to move. In these that are here, you have the ones like with the round head, which are going to give you a round, soft texture. This large rounded head is for movement of big metal, so you can move some larger things with it. You have these here, which move your metal horizontally and laterally rather than in round surfaces. And you can go with rounded surfaces that are going to give you much tighter textures or much looser textures. But these are your professional grade hammers that you can use. And every hammer, of course, still gives you its own individual texture. Okay, these hammers are special to me. I like what I call found hammers. These hammers have come from hardware stores, they've come from flea markets, they've come from the hardware store and then been modified. These are not hammers that you can just pick up the phone and acquire. They have to be more found or made. This one I found at a flea market, and I don't know what it was in its original life, but it has this really unique pattern here on the head. And it gives me a very nice satin finish. I do not get a triangle. That's not what you're going to get from a texture hammer. I get little bits and pieces of all of this that you see here on my metal. And the nice thing about this hammer is it cost me about $3. This hammer here I bought at a discount hardware store because I wanted a nice new 8-ounce ball peen hammer, and I thought that I would be able to use this end for my design stamps and this end to get a nice rounded hammered look on my metal. But then when I went to use it, I realized that it had this really steep hump here, and it makes a very unique rice pattern. And you can see I call it rice. I name my hammers. So this one is my satin, this one is my rice, and then this is one that another artist modified, and I actually traded beads for it, but I think she sells them at some of her shows. But she took this, this is just your hardware store grade hammer, and she modified it using, I would imagine, a graver or a diamond bit, and she modified a pattern into it. And I call it Curly. It's labeled Curly here, and I've drawn on there the type of pattern that I'll get. And again, I don't get a perfect round shape with little curlicues. I get bits and pieces, and this one to me comes out looking like a flocked wallpaper on the metal when I'm finished. And you'll get to see each of these in action when we start doing the texture demo. Okay, first of all, with texture, you have intentional texture. That is the texture that you use a specific hammer, be it one that you found or a commercial hammer or whatever, and it's going to put texture into your metal on purpose, all right? And then you have non-intentional texture in which you get when you use a surface that has been gotten dings or dents, or it has imperfections in it that accidentally transfer to your metals. So you have non-intentional texturing. And this brings up the point of, when do you use what type of hammer? If you are wanting a nice smooth surface, like if you're finishing off your ear wires or making a nice smooth paddled piece for a piece of jewelry, you want to have a hammer that you've kept pristine, that's nice and shiny, it has no marks or scratches in it, and you want to have a surface to work on that, again, has not had the transfer of all of your different texture hammers and so forth put onto it. That's why if you were using design stamp, you would not want to use this type hammer to use on a design stamp, because when you strike the design stamp, you're going to transfer the dents to the hammer. If you'll notice here, this brass hammer is made for using with the design stamps. And because it has struck so many different design stamps, it has made the ends of those make impressions here. So this would not be a hammer that I would want to use if I was working on a piece of metal that I wanted to be smooth and shiny. I would want to have a pristine, non-grooved hammer with a non-grooved, smooth surface. And that's when you would bring in your normal one. We're going to get started with our metal, and what we're going to use today is 24 gauge copper sheet. And I have here a strip that is 1¼ inches wide and 6 inches long. And we're going to divide this into 6 separate pieces. So we're going to put it with the ruler, and you're going to mark your 1-inch sections here. And then you can use metal shears. What I'm using here are actually pruning shears, but just some kind of a shear to cut your metal, or you can use a jeweler's saw. Okay, so we're gonna cut these strips straight across, and you don't have to worry about them being exact. And these are going to be the plates that we use for our texturing. There it is. Okay, once you have all your pieces, what I usually do is I go ahead and I take my shears and I just cut the tips off of each one. And that just takes some of the filing you'll have to do later away. You just have to round these edges then, and that way you don't have any sharp points on what you're going to be texturing. And you're going to do that with all of your pieces. Okay, I've cut the corners off of all 6 of the pieces that I have, and I'm not going to worry about filing or cleaning the edges or anything yet, because when we go in and we texture with the hammers, we're going to put texture along the edges, and you're just going to have to file and smooth again later. So don't bother with that right now. All right, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to flatten these pieces, and what I have are 2 old antique irons, and this is what I use for my bench blocks. And if you don't have this, you can use a bench block and two bench blocks, or an anvil and a bench block, or 2 of the white type cutting boards, and you can just take your metal and put them in between and stamp them down, and that gets them nice and flat. And you can also use a soft blow hammer, such as rawhide or plastic, to get them down also. But I found that I get a much flatter surface by smashing each one in between, or whacking them in between. And that gets all your edges down. And that's the one disadvantage to using a shear over a jeweler saw, is a shear does rather warp your metal out just a little bit, so that you have to flatten them down. If I had had a straight sheet of metal and I had used my jeweler saw, then it wouldn't have been as warped out. But then it takes a little longer, and the shears are just a little bit easier to use when you're doing straight cuts. So we have our flat pieces ready to start our texture. I want to show you the proper way in which you should hold a hammer so that you can get the most out of the hammer before you even start. First thing is the hammer's designed and weighted with the handle and the head. The hammer is designed so that you hold it back here in the back, and they've actually put a hump here, which is a grip. They've done everything for you except, right, hold this here on the hammer. When you're holding the hammer this way, you should have a comfortable positioning of your elbow. It shouldn't be up in the air like this or down against your body. It should be kind of out like this, and the hammer should flow in your hand. You should not be moving your arm up and down. The hammer should flow. If you choke up on the hammer and you hold it all the way up against the head, you've taken all the power and the strength that this hammer had away from it, and you've placed it all back into your body. And believe it or not, you will strike your fingers more by holding the hammer like this and hammering than you will if you will hold it back here like this. Another thing you want to make sure to not do is, and I have this habit, I put my finger up front here, and now I'm having to break this bad habit and retrain myself to hold the hammer in a fist. If you begin by holding your hammer with your finger up front like this, what you're going to do is you're going to set tendonitis, you're going to get carpal tunnel, it can just really lead to a lot of bad things for you. So go ahead, if you're new at this, and train yourself to hold the hammer in the proper position, in the proper way, with your body in the proper type of alignment to your metals. Okay, we're gonna take our first piece and we're gonna texture it using a commercially bought texture hammer. And first of all, what I wanna talk to you about is, when do you get good enough that you quit hitting your fingers with the hammer? Well, you don't. So what I have come up with, because I don't like hitting my fingers, is I take a clothespin and I take it apart. And here we go. They normally slide right off. These things here, I have not figured out what to do with them yet, but I save them because they will eventually turn into something. But you have this nice little coil. But you take your end of your clothespin and you put it right against the metal. Now, it's very important to hold the metal, because if you just lay the metal on your bench block and you start hammering on it, it's gonna slip and slide, and most likely it's gonna go flying across the room, and you might either lose it or you're gonna hit somebody that might be sharing your table with you. So we're gonna use the end of the clothespin to steady the metal so that we can texture. Now, you can see here on this texture hammer, I have kind of a salt and pepper shaker look. If I hammer straight down, I am not going to get a perfect circle of salt and pepper shaker. I'm going to get bits and pieces of circles. So what I have to do is I'm going to move throughout the whole piece so that I cover it completely with the circles. So I'm going to hold my metal and I'm going to start on my edges and start hammering in. If you start in the center of your piece and you hammer out, you're going to stretch your piece of metal in so that it grows larger than what your original piece. So if you've already cut your piece to the size you want it to be, I would suggest that you hammer along the outside edges first. That's work hardening the outside edge and maintaining the size of metal that you have. If you start in the center and work out, your metal's going to grow. All right, so we're going to start on the outside edge. And you can see I'm getting dots. Nowhere on there did I have a complete circle of dots, but it's by continuing around. And I like to get my edges so that they're ruffled. And I get all my edges done. So I've work hardened the outside edge of my metal. And now I'm going to start coming in. Now you can see that we have texture throughout the whole piece along our edges, but right in these areas here, I have kind of some gaps. So that's some areas I might go in and try to hammer just a little bit to fill in these gaps. So kind of focus and fill in those gaps. And we have a nicely textured piece here. Not quite finished yet, but we're ready to go with our next step on that. Okay, you can see along the top edges of my piece here that I didn't hit along the edges here. If you use your texture hammer and you really hit along the edges of your piece of metal, you're going to make sharp edges that you're going to have to file away later. What we're going to do when we're finished with all six of our pieces is I'm going to go back in with another hammer and I'm going to bevel the edges as a texture on my pieces and make it so that it really flows and shines. So try not to hit too much on the edges of your pieces with your texture hammer. Okay, this is another one of your commercial hammers that you can purchase. It already has the texture built in. And this is the one that I seem to get the most questions from students. And it's because it has these beautiful little stars down the side and these little lines and all here. And people think that they're going to be able to take their metal and just stamp, 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 and have all these beautiful little stars going across their piece. And au contraire, it is not going to work that way. And so you're going to come in and you're going to say something's wrong with the hammer. And it's not. You got to remember, that's not what a texture hammer is about. If you want perfect little star stamps across the surface of your metal, you need to use texture stamps. A hammer is not going to do that. So what we're going to do is we're going to show you what you can expect from a hammer like this. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of start here and then I'll move down over here and then up, because if I start here and I start hammering across, what's going to happen is my metal is going to grow in length as I go, because it's kind of like a wave and I'll be pushing the metal forward, and I don't want to do that. I want to keep my pieces kind of the shape, as much close to the same shape as I can. So I'm going to start on the edge. Oh, there went that finger. And you see we've got all the little pieces, and then we're going to come in. And I'm going down the edge, and really where it's hitting basically is right here. These edges out here are kind of rounded, and I'm getting most of my texture right here. So this is the area that I want to aim on the metal. And that's kind of the texture you're going to get with this hammer, not the pretty little stars. You're going to get all these little triangles, and it's going to look kind of like, to me, it looks like a snowflake that you can see through glass. So you're getting it, but it's kind of distorted. All right, and that's with this hammer. We're on piece three, and we're going to use this new hammer that came out, and it has 9 heads that you can screw off and replace and put back on, and it has all these nice little heads here, and it really works quite well. But what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to show you one. You've seen what these type textures here do, but I'm going to show you one that's a little bit unique. And it's kind of nice because you, on the other side, I've got just my regular domed piece here that does a really nice textured, which you get a texture that's your traditional hammered look. But we're gonna use this side right now. And so I'm gonna go ahead and move these out of the way. I'm gonna use metal on metal on metal. So I'm gonna get a particular impression here. And then I'm gonna switch and do something else with the same hammer. So I'm holding the hammer, and remember, we don't have to worry so much with this one about where we start, because it's such a small surface that I'm hitting here that it's not going to stretch my metal out as much. So I'm just going to kind of go in random areas around here to cover the surface. So I'm going to hammer, and I'm getting these tight, don't want to get my finger, I'm going to get these tight little dots all over. Okay, just kind of random around. And you get a polka dot look. Now, I'm going to take this metal and I'm going to move my anvil away. And I'm going to take the metal and I'm going to turn it upside down. And remember, I'm working on a rubber mat. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the same texture on a rubber mat. So I have metal on metal into rubber. And this is kind of a repoussé sort of texture that we're going to get here. So now we're going to take it. And you can see it's much larger dots. turn it. And it's stretching my metal just a little bit. That's okay. And this one, when I'm through, I call kind of a frog skin. And you can see that it has little dots going in and then big dots poking out. And it has stretched it and domed it just a little bit. So all I do is bring it back into my anvil. And I use just a soft flow because I don't want to change the shape any. And just gently hammer down my edges so that it's nice and flat again. And if you want to add more dots, you can go back in. You can add more of the tiny dots on the anvil. And you get the really tiny little raindrops. Or you can go turn it, there's the front, turn it upside down on the rubber surface. A really neat bumpy surface on here. It's really kind of cool. Okay, on piece number 4, I'm going to use the hammer that has been altered. And this was done with a diamond bit. This is just a ball peen hammer picked up from a hardware store. And the surface has been altered, filing it in. And you can do a lot of different things with your own hammers. Believe me though, it's not easily done, but if you have patience, you can get a surface into the head of your hammer. But this one here I call Curly Q, and you can see I have curls all over it. And once again, if I think I'm going to get a round circle of perfect little curly Qs on my metal, that's not what I'm going to get. This one, when I'm finished, gives me kind of a satin finish, and it reminds me of flocked wallpaper. So I'm going to get a flocked wallpaper look. So I'm going to have satin, and then I'm going to have smooth. So again, I'm going to hold my piece down, and I'm gripping my hammer correctly. And I'm going to, again, it's a heavy hammer, so I'm going to start around my edges to maintain the size of my metal. So I'm going to start here and move all around my edges, work hardening the sides. Now I'll start moving in. And I have a few blank areas here, so I'm going to go ahead and make sure that I get those filled in. And remember, you have a certain amount of time to hammer before your pieces work hard to the point where it won't hammer anymore. So you want to make your hits worthwhile. You don't want them to be teeny tiny little taps because you're not going to get much into your metal, but you're still work hardening your metal at the same rate as I am with my hard taps, but I'm getting texture out of it. Now we're going to come in closer on this one so that you can actually see the flocked wallpaper look that we have. And remember also that these textures are really going to pop out at us when we get the patina on there, because it adds shadow and dimension, and then all of your textures really jump out. But this is a really, really nice one when it's done. Okay, the fifth piece we're going to do here is with a hammer that I picked up at a flea market, and I have no idea what it was in its former life, but it has this really interesting pattern here on the face. It's kind of like it looks like Pink Floyd sort of. It's a triangle and a triangle and a triangle, and it's very rough here, but it gives me a really, really cool satin finish on my metal. Now, do I get a triangle? No, I don't get a triangle, but I get a nice satin finish. And again, it's a heavy hammer with a large surface here, so I'm going to start on my outside edge of my piece. And I'm going to pick up my clothespin, and I'm going to start. And I've got my edge. Move to my edges. Thank you. fill in the gaps. Gives me kind of a topographical map sort of look. And there we go. Nice surface here. Nice satin finish. Look at that. Okay, the last piece we're gonna work on is a hammer that I bought at a discount hardware store. When I got it home, I discovered that it had this really, really sharp little head right here on the end of the hammer. And when I went to use it, I was thinking that I was gonna get these nice, smooth, round swirls on my thing. And what I got instead was these very sharp little raindrops or pieces of rice, as I call them, and that's why I named this hammer rice. I do name my hammers. And again, it's even though it's a round, large surface, it has the only part that's hitting the metal is just this little bitty bump right here. So I didn't really have to do the outside. I could just kind of go all the way across because I'm not really moving big pieces of metal at one time. Now, if I keep all my rice going in one direction, or it could be rainfall, whatever you want it to be, but it looks like dropping pieces of rice, okay? But if I turn my metal and I hit it crossways, then I get kind of a basket weave look. So one hammer, again, and I can get two looks depending on what I want. Fill in all the gaps. And there we go. Not expected of what you would think you were gonna get with this nice big round head here. You thought you'd get these big smooth puddles, but you don't. You get these little sharp indentions. And I had someone say, oh, you can file that off. And I'm like, no way, this is one of my favorites. Okay, I finished texturing all of my pieces and you can see that it no longer lays flat. It's got a little bit of a warp here, and that's because as I was texturing, I was moving the metal in different directions. So I want to get this flat again. So again, I'm going to take my other little iron, and if you don't have irons, then you can use, like I said, two anvils, two bench blocks, an anvil and a bench block, two cutting boards, whatever, but just stamp them down, and if it didn't go flat, flip it over, and you're gonna get it reasonably flat and ready to go now. Okay, what we're gonna do now is we're gonna finish our edges, but I wanna talk to you just a little bit about the options you have for finishing edges. I, as a designer, don't like straight edges. That's just me personally. It doesn't mean if you do that there's anything wrong with that, but I'm gonna show you what I do with my finished edges. So I'm going to put this piece aside, and I'm just going to bring up an extra piece here just to show you a few things, and then I'm going to go back to the pieces that we've textured. You can bevel your edges with a rounded hammer, and depending on the size of the rounded point that you use, and you can have all kinds of different rounded edges, okay, you can get a different sized round dimple in there. And your round dimple, your round hammers are really your most traditional texture. This is what you're gonna see when somebody says it has a hammered look. This is really what people expect to see more so than all the different textures we were using. And it just gives you a nice puddled look. And if you go to a bigger hammer, you get that hammered look. But what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take the hammered look and I'm gonna do the edges of the pieces that we have textured. So I'm gonna pull a piece in, and I'm gonna save that one for the center. Let's go with one of these, okay? And I'm gonna take this hammer with this size ball here to do my edge. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold it, and right along the very edge of the metal, I'm going to strike. And what's going to happen is my ball is going to hit kind of halfway on the metal, halfway on the anvil, and it's going to give me a beveled edge. And I'm going to start right on the edge. And as I hit, I strike and pull. So I'm pulling the metal out and away as I strike. And I go all the way around. And it gives me this nice ruffled edge around. And then it also, if you notice, beveled the sides down. And I would do that for each piece. Do one more so you can see. See how I have these straight edges here? And to me, that's like boring. So I'm gonna come in and I'm going to bevel these. Again, using the same rounded end. And I'm pulling as I go. And that gives me that really, really interesting shape. And if you see that up against one that has not been to, you can just see, to me, this adds a lot of interest here that this piece here is missing. Now, I've shown you what I can do with trimming with a rounded edge hammer. Now I'm gonna show you what I can get when I do the edges with one that I call a cross peen, but it's nice and flat like this. And when I texture with a rounded hammer, like this one, I get the rock in the puddle. And it kind of goes out like this, like when you throw a rock in a puddle, you get these circles. When I work with a cross peen like this, my metal only moves in two directions. It moves horizontally across this way, and then it moves up and down that way. So I can get my metals to move in a different direction with a different shaped hammer. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this piece here, and what I want to do is I'm going to, this is going to be the end pieces of my bracelet, so I'm going to fan out one end. So I'm going to start in the center here, and I've got half of the hammer on the metal and half of the hammer on the anvil, or not really on the anvil because you don't want to strike your anvil, but off the metal, and I'm going to start striking. And I'm striking very close and moving out away. Okay, and now I'm going to start in the middle and I'm going to come back. And see that nice little ruffle I get? It looks like the fringe on the bottom of a scarf. Okay. And I can do one more. Very close together. And you can see there where it moved my metal out. I can come in and do it a little bit more. Then come in. And come the other way. And you can see how it flared down this way and up that way, and it gave me that nice little fringed look. And that's a neat way to add some interest to a shape. Okay, so I'm gonna go up the sides here, and I want you to notice as I'm hammering, instead of holding the metal still and moving my hammer up the metal, my hammer strikes in the same spot every time and I move the metal. That way I have control of what the hammer's doing, and I'm watching the metal, not my hammer. My hammer is striking in the same location every time, and I'm moving my piece where I need it to go. So watch this as we go. And now I'm going to come to the other side. And then down. Okay, and you can see, and then you see it's all roughly, so I'm going to turn it over. I'm going to take my other anvil. And flatten that out so that it will lay with the rest of the bracelet. And I have a nice frame around the outside. This will be my centerpiece. Okay, now we're going to get to filing the edges of our metal. Files are a very important part of the jewelry trade. You can use power tools to file, you can use hand tools to file, but there's really no way around filing one way or another. There are metal files and then there are diamond files. When I'm working, I really enjoy using a metal file. Now, the number one rule to a metal file is that you always file in one direction. You never go back and forth. If you go back and forth with a metal file, what you're doing is you're taking a burr off and then you're putting a burr on. And then you're taking a burr off and you're putting a burr on. And so you're doing absolutely nothing for your metal. And on top of that, you're filling in all the little grooves of your file with metal shavings, and then the file is no longer going to work properly for you. When you're holding your file, it can be a long file, it can be a short file. They have half round, half square. They have all kinds of different files. There's a file for every different type of thing you're going to do. My favorite is a number two file. I like a number two barrette, and then I have this one. This is a jewel I found at a flea market. It must have belonged to a jewelry maker or a watch repair person or something, but it's got a lot of character. It's very comfortable in my hand, and now it has become my favorite file. But it is also a number two cut, which is what I like to use because I can move. It's not too aggressive, but it's aggressive enough to move metal quickly. And unlike the hammer, you're going to use a handle, and you can purchase a file and then purchase a handle. You can modify handles, whatever's comfortable in your grip. And unlike the hammer, you're going to put your finger up front on this one. This one, it's okay to put your finger. Actually, it's very important. And you want to support your metal on some kind of a surface. I like to file on a block of wood or on a bench pin. You can use a rubber block, a hockey puck, whatever. If you are into precious metal clay, you might have one of those cubes. But you want to have something that you can support your metal on while you're filing. And what you do is you start, you have your piece of metal slightly over the edge of your piece of wood or whatever you're filing on. And then you take the file and you move in one direction. And then you lift, and then you move in one direction. And then we turn the metal and we move in one direction. You can notice how I'm starting on the side and coming up and over. I start on the side and up and over. And then you may have a little burr on the other side. So then you're just gonna flip it over and gently remove any burr that you got on there. Okay, one direction, always one direction, and the metal supported. Never up in the air like this, because you've got nothing supporting the metal and you're really not doing yourself or the metal any favors at all. So it can be just an inexpensive little chunk of wood or anything to support your metals on. And you're gonna go and you're gonna take, if you have any sharp corners, you wanna take those off. But we don't wanna sit here and file away all of this neat texture that we got along the edges of our piece of metal. But we don't want sharp edges either. You don't want to be cut by anything. You don't want any sharp edges to snag on clothing. So we've got to get rid of this sharp edge on the metal, and a file is not really the tool to do that with. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take a coarse sanding sponge. Now this was just your regular sanding sponge from the paint section of a hardware store, and I cut it into three pieces. That way it fits in my hand nicely, and then I end up using the entire sponge, not just sections of the sponge, because it was big. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this sponge and I'm going to file from the top down over the edge, the top down over the edge. Okay, and what that's going to do is it's going to round this edge and I'm going to do that all the way around, and then I'm going to turn it over, and I'm going to file from the top down over the edge, and the top down over the edge, and then it's going to round this, so it's going to make what was very sharp go round like this. So we start here. And now I have a nice smooth surface there that's not going to cut anybody in any way. And I'm going to do this to all six of the pieces that we have textured. Okay, I have all six of my pieces textured, filed, and sanded. And now it's time for us to start designing the bracelet that we're going to make with the pieces that we have practiced with. Now, if you need a larger bracelet, then you turn your pieces so that they are the 1 1/4 side by side. If you know that you have a much smaller wrist, then you turn your pieces so that they are like this instead. Okay. And in designing your bracelet, you should look at your pieces and decide how is it going to look the best here? What pieces do you want, like a bumpy one and a bumpy one and a satin and a satin? I put this one in the center because I ruffled the edges, but I could also take this one out, put this one in, and then cut this one to be my end and go in even just a little smaller to bring everything down. There are a lot of design options that you can do here as far as your length and the look that you want. You could even get really fancy if you wanted to and do something like this. This is your piece, so you decide what you want to do. But the most important thing right now, I think, is pick the piece that's going to become your toggle. We're going to make a toggle out of one of these pieces. And I'm going to stick with just the straight, and I'm going to make a bracelet that's going to be close to an 8-inch, 7.5. I wear multiple bracelets. I stack. So I tend to make my bracelets just a little bit larger so that I can wear more than one at a time. If you're making bracelets for inventory to sell at a show, you would want to make your bracelets to come out right around 7.5 inches, because that is the standard that will fit the majority of your customers. So you may want to make sure that it is a 7-inch. And if you measure, you come in and measure, you can see here that I'm at 8. So maybe that is a little long. Let's see what we can do here. I think I'll go. And I'm adding some space in between, because that's where my jump rings are going to be. And that's also a place that you can add some length, because you can do jump ring to jump ring here, or you could do jump ring and then a jump ring in the center and then another jump ring. So there's a lot of ways to lengthen a bracelet, many more options to lengthen a bracelet than there are to shorten the bracelet. So we're going to stick here. So I went with the 1-inch wide, so that my length here is the 6-inch, and then the 1.5 across. And then this piece here is going to be my toggle piece. All right, so I've got 6. By the time I put my toggle piece on, then I'm going to have right at about a 7.5, between a 7 and a 7.5 inch bracelet. Okay, I've decided that for my bracelet, this is the setup I'm going to have. I'm going to make my toggle out of this piece. Now, this tool is a spring-loaded punch, and to me, this is a very important tool. I use power tools a lot when I'm in my studio. I love a drill press to make holes. And before you can make any kind of hole using any kind of power tool, flex shaft, Dremel, drill press, you always have to dimple your metal first. It's very dangerous if you don't. First of all, the drill bit can't find a place to dig into the metal, and you're going to continue to add pressure and your drill bit will break. It also makes sure that you get the hole where you want and the drill bit doesn't go all over the metal and add texture that you did not intend to have on your piece. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to make the holes, and for the design that I'm going to do today, I'm going to put 3 jump rings in between each set here. Now, it's not a function thing, it's an aesthetic point. You could do 1, you could do 2, you could do as many jump rings in between as you'd like, but I'm going to do 3. And I'm not going to measure these, I'm going to eyeball it. That's just the way that I do. But if you would like to get your ruler out and come in and measure and decide, you know, the perfect even place to put 3 holes on each side of each piece, then you're welcome to do that. But this is how I do it. I put a piece, the first piece up, and I put the second piece up, and I line them up together like this. Okay, then I come in with my spring-loaded punch, and I want to come in about 1/8 inch from the edge here. Okay, so here's my edge, and I'm going to come in 1/8 inch, and I'm about 1/4 inch from the edge, and I'm going to come in, I'm going to put 1 right there. Right, then I'm going to come to the center and I'm going to come about 1/8 inch in, and then I'm going to do the same thing down here. Now, as long as this one and this one match, it doesn't really matter to me so much if this one is a little bit closer than this one. I don't sweat over the small stuff, but like I said, you're welcome to use a ruler if you would like. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to come in, and I've got that hole there, so I'm going to put this one right here. And I'm going to come in here, and then I'm going to come in across here. Now, those 2 match. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to turn this one over, and there's 1. And I'm going to turn this one over, and there's 2. Now I bring my center piece up, 1/4 inch down, 1/8 inch in, stamp, 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 come straight across, stamp, stamp, stamp. Put that piece down. This is 3 and 4. So you've got the idea of what we're doing here. And the reason I number them is because I might have some differences here in the spacing between my dimples, and if I don't get the pieces lined up, then the bracelet will ride a little bit crooked, which isn't the worst thing in the world. I've dimpled each of my squares, and I use the dimpler again because I have the option now of using a power tool or using a manual hole punch. The other thing too is, if I had just used a marker and marked each of these holes, there's the opportunity that, say, I got up and went for lunch, or I came back and had to answer the phone or something, and then picked this piece up or something, those marks can get smudged and moved. So I really like to use the dimpler because the marks are there permanently. It also gives me a place for, if I'm using the manual pliers or the 2-hole punch, then it gives a place for the tooth to really catch, because it's very difficult to see once you get the metal inside there, which you'll understand in a minute. Now, I'm looking at my sizing, and I have it, and it is 6 inches, and I know the size I am, a 6-inch bracelet is not going to fit. But I want to stick with a particular size jump ring because of the look the finished piece is going to have. So what I'm going to do is I have my holes here, 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 and here. I've not made any dimples on this end or this end. I'm going to leave those blank until I get the entire bracelet put together. Then I have the option of coming in and having 1 hole here for the toggle bar, or I can go in and I can have 2 holes here, which I would put a jump ring and a jump ring, and then I would have a 3rd jump ring linking those jump rings together to add some length at the end here. And I can add chain also for the toggle bar as long as I want it to go. But this is where I play with my length, because as you remember, when I turned these sideways, the bracelet was much too big by the time I put a toggle on. But if I turn them this way, for me personally, it's going to be a little snug. So I have that option of playing with extra jump rings in the middle or extra jump rings on the end. And because of the look that I want, I'm going to play with the jump rings on the end to lengthen my bracelet. So leave these blank. Okay, we have our piece now. We have our dimples in our piece marking the location that we're going to put our holes. And what I have here today are two of the most popular hole making tools in the industry. We have the two hole punch and we have the hand punch plier. The two hole punch gives you two size holes. In standard measurement, you have a 1/16 hole and a 3/32 hole. And if you go by metric measurement, which is what this tool is, it's a 1.8 millimeter, which is the same as the 1/16. And then over here, it's about a 2 millimeter, a little bit larger than a 2 millimeter, which would accommodate a 3/32. The reason we're gonna go with the 1/16 or the 1.8 millimeter is because we're going to be using 16 gauge wire to make our jump rings. Okay, so I'm going to demo with the two hole punch first. These you twist down, and you see there's that little plunger there, and you twist down and it will go through the metal, and then you twist all the way back up and it releases. Now remember I said I like a dimple better than a marker, because once I get this inside here, if you'll notice, let's get this angled right and up, the light catches on the dimple. See how the light catches on the dimple? And then I can actually get the plunger to go into the dimple. If I had a marker mark there, when I hold it sideways like this so that I can see it, then I can no longer see the mark because it's flat there. So by getting it into the dimple, I know that I have it securely where it's supposed to be, and I don't have as many chances of getting my hole in the wrong location. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna crank this down, and you wanna hold it so it doesn't spin with you. And I'm gonna crank it down and become one with your tools. If this doesn't cut through the metal fairly easily with just a little bit of pressure, then it's not the correct tool to use to make the hole. If you're gritting your teeth and opening this like it's a stuck pickle jar, chances are you're going to break the tool and then nobody's gonna be happy. So get a feel for your tools. Listen to your tools when they're talking to you. So again, I'm coming down. You can see the light reflecting off of my dimple. The tooth catches in the dimple. I turn. It's in. Now I come up until it releases. So I have the 16 gauge holes that will accommodate the 16 gauge. And again, it has a tooth and it has a little bit of a curve to it. So when you come in, see the light reflecting off my dimple? I come in, catch in the dimple, pop. And again, if I'm gritting my teeth and having to apply a whole bunch of pressure to the tool, it's not the right tool for making the hole. And this one is just a little bit more difficult to get off. You have to wiggle it off. And sometimes that can make your hole just a little bit larger than you need it to be when you're riveting. So try to get it off without stretching your hole out too much. But now we have our holes. And see, you can see before I mentioned that this one and this one might be a little closer than this one and this one. That's okay, because on the other side, they're gonna match because I numbered them. So it's not gonna matter so much. But if that's really something that bothers you, then go in and measure. So we're gonna put our holes in all the pieces down through the center. Okay, I have all of my holes down the center of my bracelet. And remember, I told you not to do the ones on the edges yet, just the ones down the center. Now, regardless of what you use to make your holes, you're gonna get a little bit of a burr on the back. And you have to remove this burr so that your jump rings will flow evenly through it. If you were setting a rivet, you want the burr to be gone so that your rivet will set flush against the metal. So it's just really important to remove any of the burrs. And a burr is that little piece of metal that sticks up on the edge of the metal once you've punched a hole. Now, the most common way to do that would be to take your file and pick your piece up and file across the burr and remove the burr. And that's a good efficient way to do it. Remember, we're moving in one direction. We don't have to use our wood block so much because I'm supporting it with my finger and I'm moving across and I'm removing the burrs, okay? But let's say that we're working on a piece that had texture on the front and the back. And you can see we're going to patina these, and I'm getting scratch marks in my piece from my file. And it's very important in the jewelry industry, especially now that it's become such a popular hobby for people, that the backs of your pieces look as good as the fronts of your pieces, especially if you're trying to get into a show that's juried. So you don't want any unnecessary marks or scratches on the back. So what you can do is you can file away your burrs, or you can take just a drill bit from the hardware store. Now, this is a 1/8 drill bit. I'm not sure what size drill bit that is, but you can buy them by 1/8, and it's larger than the hole that we have drilled. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to lay this down on my mat, and I have it in a pin vise. And you don't have to put it in a pin vise. You can put it in a reamer tool, you can put it in a pin vise, but it just makes it easier to grasp the drill bit. You can actually just hold the drill bit and do it, but if you have a lot of holes to clean out, that can become very painful to your hands or even cause a blister. So put it in a vise, and this is a really nice one because it has the pivoting head, and so I'll be able to put it in the palm of my hand and turn. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the drill bit and I put it in the hole and I turn. And what that does is it removes the burr and it makes a hole that is like countersunk in. So it's not just a hole anymore, it actually has a beveled edge to it. And this is really a handy trick when you're doing your riveting, because then your rivet material flares out inside that little bowl that's created, and you can pretty much come out with flush set rivets. Give it a little twist. You can see that one has still just a little bit of a burr on it. I'm just going to go in and twist that off. I'm going to do one more just so you can really see how this cleans out. You can see it pull that burr right off of there. See? And there you go. You've got this beautiful no more burr piece of metal. And because it's nice and flared, the jump rings fit in there nice and neat and move freely. Okay, we've put our holes in our pieces, and now what we want to do is we don't want a bunch of flat pieces to make a round bracelet. So what we're going to do is we're going to put just a gentle curve in each one of these pieces. And the best tool for doing that, in my opinion, is the bracelet bending pliers. And you can see it has this nice little curve here. And what you want to do is you're going to hold it, and you want it holding to where when you're looking at it, it's got a frowny face. Okay, and that'll get your curve going in the right direction. So you have, here's these little eyes and here's your frowny face. And then you want to make sure that you've got it going in the right direction on the bracelet. Our bracelet is going to be stacked like this. So we want our curves to go like that. So I pick up my piece, I have my frowny face, and I start right here. And you can see how it's in there like that, and just munch across. And see, it gave me this nice little curve compared to the straight. So we're going to come in and I kind of go down the center here. Then I come out on the edges, make sure I've got a nice curve. And that gives me this nice little curve here. So that when I put these together, you can see they're going to start forming the curve of a bracelet. And I'm going to do that to every piece. All right, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 pieces that I have punched my holes in. I've curved them. Now I'm going to make my toggle. So I've saved piece number 6, and that's this one right here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to come in here with my shears, and I'm going to cut a section that is about 1/4 inch wide off. And that's going to be my toggle bar. And this is going to be my toggle ring. And file my corner just a little bit, just to get that sharp edge off that I put on when I cut it. And we're going to do the same thing for the toggle piece. We need to add the texture along the edge so that it matches on both sides there. So I'm going to take my rounded hammer. Okay. And do the same thing here. These matching all the other pieces. You can take your sponge, get your raw edges off. Okay, now we get to play with a fun tool. We're going to put a 1/2 inch hole in this piece. So we're going to use a disc cutter to cut a circle in here. Now, if you don't have a disc cutter, you don't have to say, oh, I can't do this project. You can put a hole in the metal. You can put your jeweler saw in there, cut a circle out, cut a shape. You just wanna, you know, get a shape in here, a hole in here, so that you can make a toggle out of it. But we're gonna use a disc cutter. Okay, this is gonna be the end piece. This is number 1 of my bracelet. And I'm going to put my toggle right up against the end like this. So I have to decide where my hole's going to be that I'm going to punch in to make the toggle. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to come over here and I'm going to say, okay, I think that would be a good spot for my circle. All right. And then this is going to be the piece that is up against piece number 5, and this is going to be my toggle bar. And this is where I said I could add some length with chain here, but I'm going to come in and I'm going to put a hole right there in the center that will be where I'm going to hook it over here. So I'm going to put a hole here and a hole here. Okay. And those are going to be holes where I'm going to connect that with chain. But right now, what we're going to do is we're going to use the disc cutter, and I'm going to put a 1/2 inch hole in. And what I want to do is I want to put this, slide this up underneath until the X that I drew is centered in my disc cutter. That way I know my circle is going to be where I want it to be. And then tighten that down. Okay, so I have my piece locked into the disc cutter. You can see my X is in there. This is where I'm going to cut my circle. And I have the appropriate disc that's going to cut the circle. Now, very important, this silver side that has a 90 degree edge here, this is the side that cuts. This is the side that slips into the hole. The black side up here that has a beveled edge is the side that we're going to hammer. It's very important not to get these switched around, because first of all, you're not going to get a hole in your metal. You're going to get a big dent, and chances are you're going to really mess up the cutter, and then it's not going to work properly for you from then on out. So make sure that you're putting the cutting edge in the proper hole and that it fits with no air around the edge, and that you're striking the appropriate end. And I'm going to turn this around because I'm right-handed, so I want to be able to grasp the disc cutter with my left hand so that it doesn't jump when I hit it. And I'm going to use a brass hammer here, and I'm going to strike this and it will cut through the metal. Then I lift the whole piece up. I'll have a half inch little disc sitting on the ground. I'll unscrew this and I'll have my toggle piece with a hole in it. So we have this, and it's going to be loud. Okay, so it's in there. Now I pick it up. It slides through. There's my half inch disc. I open up, slide out my metal, and there is my toggle. Just to stay with the theme of my bracelet that I had a while ago, I'm going to take my spring-loaded punch and I'm going to make 1, 2, 3 holes. And even though this is domed already, I'm going to go ahead and punch it. If I need to re-dome it, I can do that, but it didn't really do anything to it. And now I'm going to make those 3 holes to put this piece together. Alrighty, we have our hole in our toggle. I've punched my 3 holes in my toggle ring so that it can be attached to the bracelet, and I've punched 1 hole in my toggle bar so it can be attached to the opposite end of the bracelet, and I've used the brace of bending pliers to gently dome the toggle ring. And I also gently domed the toggle bar because then it will fit smoothly on my toggle because they have the same little dome there. And we're ready to start on jump rings. Now what we're going to do is we're going to make our jump rings to put our bracelet together. And we're going to use 16 gauge copper wire. And I'm going to use the medium sized wrap and tap tool to make the coil for my jump rings. And for this bracelet, there's 3 size barrels here, and I'm going to use the center barrel. This is the size that I'm wanting for my jump rings here. And to properly use it, what I do is I leave my wire on the coil. That way I can make exactly how many jump rings I want without wasting any wire. So I leave the coil and I hold my pliers so that the rubber is facing me. It's the closest to my body. And my barrels are further from my body. And I bring the wire in and I make it so that it is flush up against the barrels, just like that, flush. And I hold it in my dominant hand, and with my non-dominant hand, I take and I put my thumb right up against the wire because I'm gonna add a lot of tension as I turn. And what I'm going to do with my dominant hand is I'm going to twist away from my body while I push with my thumb, okay? And I don't let go of the pliers. I open the pliers, pivot the barrel inside the loop that I've made, bite down, and twist away from my body again. This time when I twist, and I'm going to do that again, I want the length of my wire to come to the inside. So here's the tip of my wire, and my wire here is coming to the inside. It's the closest to the joint of the plier. That way I can continue making my coil, and I can make this coil as long as I need to without having to worry about running out of room. Lengthen my wire out and continue. Now for this bracelet, I need 3, 6, 9, 12, 15 of this size. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 13, 14, and I'm gonna make 1 or 2 extras. You never hurts to make 1 or 2 extras. Okay, so there, and I slide it off, and I have a perfect coil of jump rings for my project. And I'm going to cut this off. And I have my coil. Now what we're going to do is we're going to take our coil and we're going to take our bracelet pieces and we're going to add a liver of sulfur patina to them. Now I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to put this in the liver of sulfur and patina it in a coil before I cut it. This way when it comes out of the patina I can rinse it and then clean my jump rings all at one time and then cut it apart. That way I'm not having to clean 15 separate little jump rings. I can do it all at one time as a coil. And you'll see that in just a second. We've patinaed our pieces in a liver of sulfur solution. And if you have not ever used liver of sulfur to patina your metals, you can go to the free video oxidizing and polishing here at Beaducation and learn how to use it properly. If you notice here, I also have a smaller coil. I did the larger coil as an example for you, and then I did a smaller coil also on the same tool, only this was the medium barrel and this one was the smallest barrel. And this is a 7 millimeter ID inside diameter, and this is a 5 millimeter ID inside diameter jump ring. You can see my coils no longer look like copper. They look like they're really black here. So what I want to do is I want to get some of this patina off because I don't want my piece to stay black looking in this. It is an option you have, but we're not going to do that in this piece. And I'm going to clean it off with steel wool. And this is considered 4-aught steel wool, which is 0000 steel wool. And that means it's how fine it is. It's very fine. And you notice that I left the jump rings in a coil. Well, it's much easier to clean the excess patina off with it in a coil shape than it is to have gone ahead and cut it up, put each little piece in the liver of sulfur solution, brought it back out, and then cleaned each one individually. So I cheat and I leave it in a coil. And so what I do now is and I like to buff on my black surface here. It keeps the pieces from rolling around the rubber surface that I work on. There we go. And you can see it is much faster to do this when it's a coil. And you can see the difference here. And I'll do this small one. And this is not a Brillo pad. There's no soap or anything on this. This is steel wool. And you can usually purchase it at your home improvement stores over in the paint department. But you don't want to use a Brillo pad or SOS pad because they have soap on them. This is a different type of material. And it's going to shred up on you. I have found that if you buy the really, really, really discounted steel wools, they're going to tear up more on you than just your regular grade. So there you go. And then I have my pieces, and this is when you're really gonna see your texture pop out at you. And I love the look. It's like unwrapping a Christmas present because suddenly all that work you did with your texture hammers shows up. See, you get shadow, you get dimension, all of the lines show up. And I recommend that you clean the backs also. And your hands look wonderful after you do this. But you're going to get each one of your pieces cleaned up. And the patina showing on them, and they look great. Here are all the components of our bracelet. They have been patinaed and cleaned off, and I've got them lined up, and I have all of my holes matching. So our next step now is to cut our jump rings so that we can start putting everything together. And because of the size jump rings that we have made, we are going to use a jeweler's saw and a little jump ring jig that I have to saw these in half or in, apart otherwise. And we're going to put this thing together and I'm going to show you how to use this. Let me show you one of my little contraptions I have here. I didn't invent it, but I use this very often. I discovered it up in the mountains of North Carolina at a jewelry art school that I instruct at. And it's for cutting jump rings. And it's very easy to construct. It's just a 1x1 piece of wood and you cut it about, 3, maybe 4 inches long. And then you cut a V in it. This is if you're left-handed. This is a V in here. And then you just take a little piece of plexiglass and you screw that in and you've got a slot right here where your saw blade goes. And the leather is so that you can hold your jump rings up firmly against the plexiglass, and also your jump rings as you're sawing it creates friction and so they become warm. So the leather keeps your finger from getting burned while you're sawing. And you're gonna see in just a second how this thing really works. And it's really nice because you can make one for pennies and you're gonna fall in love with it when you do to give it a try. So we're going to use our jeweler's saw, our jump rings, and a little bit of beeswax here. Now we're going to saw apart our jump rings. And I know everybody goes, the jeweler's saw, I hate the jeweler's saw. Well, to be successful in the jewelry craft, the jewelry trade, you have to become one with your jeweler's saw. There's just no way around it. And once you do get over the hang up of the jeweler's saw, you get into this jewelry saw zen and you will love your jeweler's saw. But this is one way that you can make a bunch of jump rings at one time. They'll all be flush cut and in the end you'll be much happier with what you've got. So what we're going to do is we have your basic jeweler's saw here and we have a blade in it, and you know that when you are using a jeweler's saw, your blade should be set in to where when you run your fingers away from the handle, you feel the teeth. Now, if you have very good eyesight and you can see the teeth, then it would look like a half of a Christmas tree, sort of. But you, when you run your fingers away, you feel the teeth. And it's locked in here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to unlock it. And the way we do that is we have a nut up here and a nut down here. And I'm going to loosen this nut down here. Okay, and I'm going to slide my coil on. What I'm doing here is I'm bracing the handle of the saw frame against my body, and I've got the coil on here, and I'm going to tighten this saw blade. And normally I would put it up against the table and push, but for right now I'm going to just push down and tighten there. Okay, and I may not have mentioned before, but this is a 2/0 saw blade, and this is what I use when I'm working with the size metals that I'm with, 24 gauge, 16 gauge. This is just a really good size saw blade to use for most of your work. And you want this to be really tight. Now you're not going to get that nice ping that you get when you're going to saw into sheet, because you've got the coil on here and it acts as it kind of flattens the tone that you get, so you're not going to hear that nice little ping, but you can feel the tension. All right, I recommend once you've got your piece on here that you put some sort of a lubricant on here. What we have here today is cut lube, but you can use beeswax, you can use a candle, you can use soap, but you want to use something that's going to lubricate your blade. And I have found that if I lubricate the back of my saw blade, then I don't get the lubricant gummed up in the teeth of my saw, and it works just a little bit better for me. So I'm going to put this in, and you remember I had the little tail on there? Well, I'm going to have the tail going up. Remember I had that little tail? I'm going to put that going up, and I bring my leather over, and I'm going to put my finger here. And I'm gonna push this coil, I'm bringing this towards me, and I'm pulling the coil towards the plexiglass window. And now I'm gonna bring my saw, and I'm not gonna saw straight across, I'm gonna bring it so that it's kind of like at a 45 degree angle. Okay, I'm gonna stop here so you can just see what I've done. Let's see. And I continue sawing here, and you notice that the pointer finger of my left hand, this one here, I'm pushing these jump rings towards the plexiglass. And I'm keeping this at an angle, and I can feel the jump rings as they pop loose. Okay, and whoop, there they popped. There's a bunch more. And you come back in. And we'll get the last ones here. And I can feel them. When you get down to the last one or two, they stick. All right. And I made a few extras so we don't have to worry about those. They'll pop loose. Okay, so now we have our jump rings and we're ready to put these onto our bracelet. Let's say that you don't have a jeweler saw or you're not in love with the jeweler saw and you want to cut your jump rings. You can always use a flush cutter like this. And what we're gonna do is you come in and you cut. And remember, cut only one at a time. You cannot sit there and cut this whole thing like this, okay? You cut one jump ring at a time. And you're thinking, well, why didn't you just do that to begin with? That's so much easier. Well, because when you do it this way, you end up with a jump ring that has a slanted side on one side and a flat cut on the other side, and you have to get rid of that slanted side. So when your cutters, if you're looking at them, this one has like a bowl. It looks kind of like a plow, all right? And when you turn them over, they're nice and flat back here. Well, this flat side cuts your jump ring straight up and down, and this side cuts it at an angle. So you go back into your cutters, and you find the angled side, and you make sure the flat side of your cutter is against that, and put your fingers over it so that you don't shoot these little pieces in your eyes, and you cut that off, and now you have a flush cut. And you have to go back in and do that with every piece. And these are the smaller of our jump rings, which we're going to use for the chain that is going to go on the toggle bar. And there we go. Now all of our pieces are flush cut. I have all of my jump rings cut, and now it's time to start linking the bracelet parts together. And we're just going to start with this one piece here first, and I'm going to show you how to open and shut the jump rings and work hard in them so that they should stay shut once you have them in the holes so that your bracelet doesn't come apart. For opening and shutting your jump rings, I recommend that you use a pair of pliers in each hand. So you're going to need two pairs of pliers. Today what I have is one pair of bent nose and one pair of chain nose pliers. You can use two chain, two bent, two square, but you need to have two pliers, one for each hand, and you need to make sure that they are pliers that do not have any teeth on the inside. All right, those are not good for working in jewelry. I'm going to grasp the jump ring firmly in one of the pairs of pliers, and then I'm going to take the other one in, and what I'm going to do is I'm just going to work it back and forth just a little bit, and I'm going to bring this and so that it overlaps, and then I'm going to bring it back, and then I'm going to bring it so that it overlaps on the other side, and you'll hear it click into place. Okay, hear that click? That means that I have work hardened the metal down here in this area, and I have removed any gaps of space that could be in the opening of the jump ring, and this should keep it from coming open unless it's been really, really pulled hard. I have work hardened three of my jump rings, and now I'm going to put this first set of components together. So I'm going to take my opening and open it up. And I feed it into the top hole and into the top hole come in and do it again so that it clicks. And there's my first jump ring. Now I'll pick up the second one, open it up, feed one side in, feed the second side in, cross it over again. You can hear it click. There's two. Open it up. Okay, you can continue closing your jump rings, linking your pieces all the way to the end of the bracelet. I have all of my pieces linked together now with my jump rings, and I'm going to use the smaller jump rings that we made to make a short piece of chain that I'm going to attach to the toggle bar, which we're going to attach to the end of the bracelet. I'm using my two pliers again, and I'm going to close this one and remember to work hard in those. You never open a jump ring out. You always open and shut your jump rings side to side. If you ever pull it open out, you'll never get it lined back up again like it's supposed to be. Oh, that one's not shut. And I think I'm going to need probably four jump rings for this toggle bar. And I've put it on, but I won't really know until I get it on the bracelet, so I'm assuming. Get it nice and shut. I have my chain link now, and I have a few extras here in case I need to add a little bit of length to get it to go up through the hole of the toggle ring here. So we're going to add it to the end of our bracelet, and I think I'm going to use one of my leftover large jump rings to go into the bracelet. And then hook my chain to it and close it up. And voila, we have an awesome bracelet made out of 1 1/4 inch by 6 inch strip of metal and some 16 gauge wire. There you go. Here's our finished bracelet. Bonus question. Who out there can see the mistake that I made in my bracelet? How did I know that I had a mistake here? Well, when I was putting this together and I was trying it on, I noticed that my movement right here was not what it should be. See how these pieces, they're overlapping here? There shouldn't have been any overlap there. Plus, if you notice here, this jump ring goes uphill. So that tells me that something wasn't aligned here. The biggest clue just by looking was that my texture is different, but let's say that I had not textured the outside of my piece differently, I would have still been able to tell that that was not in the right location because of the overlap and it not flowing like it's supposed to. It should flow like these pieces are without rubbing back and forth. Technically, my bracelet is finished, but there's a few more things that I would do before I would consider it really, really done. Personally, I would throw it in my tumbler and tumble it for about an hour. And what that would do, that would burnish all of these high spots of my texture and make them really pop out from the patina. It would also work harden my jump rings even further than what I did so that the bracelet won't come apart. If I don't have a tumbler or if I choose not to tumble it or don't have the time, then I would seal each of these pieces and the jump rings and so forth with Renaissance wax. Let it dry. If I want a matte finish, I'm going to just leave it the way it is after the Renaissance wax dries. Or if I want a shiny finish, I'll let the Renaissance wax dry and then I'll take a soft cloth like old t-shirt material and I would buff it back up the old wax on wax off routine. And then I would have a nice shiny finish that will retard the natural process of further oxidization. And we have it like this. And then here's the back. You can see our numbers, but that's okay. And then comes around, toggle goes through. There's what that looks like. And there's what that looks like. And we have a very nice bracelet here. Okay, now that we've finished our bracelet and we've talked about all of our tools and we're happy with the results we've got, let's go back and think of a few things that might have popped up in your head while you were watching the video. Some questions you might have had that I hear a lot from people, and let's see if we can answer some of those for you. You've been hammering, you've got your metal, you're hammering, and you notice that you have nothing happening to the metal anymore. I call this you're beating the proverbial dead horse. It's just not going anywhere any longer. Well, what you've done is you've work hardened the metal, and it's not going to move anymore for you, and chances are it's going to split or crack. There are ways to get around that. You can anneal the metal, which is a process in heating the metal up either with a torch or in a kiln that realigns the crystalline structure on the inside so that you can go in and hammer a little bit more with it. The thing about work hardening and getting the most out of your metal while you're using your texture hammers is make the hits on the hammer work for you. If you are lightly tapping and you're not getting anything out of it, or you're hammering like I was and you listened to me on the tape and you heard what the hammer sounded like, if when you were working on your metal it didn't sound like that and it sounded more tinkery, you were getting the same work hardening results as I was, but without the movement. You've got to learn to let the hammer do the work. But it's not a lost cause. You can go and anneal your metal and start over again. Let me show you the difference between really hammering and getting the potential out of the hammer to transfer texture to your metal, and then what I call tinkering with the metal. All right, when I'm hammering, I'm holding my surface and I'm hammering. Okay, then you get the tinkerer. That's, or even worse, holding the hammer like this. And there, if you could see, they're totally different. But at the same time, I was still hitting the metal, so therefore I was disrupting the crystalline structure inside the metal, and I work hardened it, but I didn't get any results showing on my metal. Okay, when it comes to filing, I hear a lot of times, when I file, all I do is put scratches on my metal, or I add burrs instead of taking burrs off. I don't like filing. Well, it's really probably in the way that you're filing, the way you're holding the file. If you're using a metal file, you have to remember, it's the most important thing, is that you can only go in one direction. All right, so, and you want to have it supported against something. You don't want to have it up in the air. We're not working on our fingernails here. We're working with metal. So you have to have your metal supported. You have to hold your file correctly. Finding a file that's comfortable in your hand is very important. You can change out the handles. You can look for different files, but you want to get the file and you want it to be comfortable. And this is one time when you can put your finger up front. It actually helps guide the file. So what you're going to do is you're going to put it against the table or against your block, and you're going to file in one direction. And what I do is I start at the top and I curl my hand up and over, okay? And I'm right-handed, so I work to the right. and I file up and over. Okay? I never come back. If I come back, what I'm going to do is add a burr and I'm going to fill up my file, and then my file is no longer going to work. If you've been using your file for a long time and suddenly you're not getting anything out of it anymore, you've probably filled all of the little ridges with metal shavings. You can get a brush, a file brush, and get all of that out of there. You can use paper or something to kind of go across, rub it on your jeans, but get the gunk out of there and then it should be working for you again. But it's all in the motion. It's nice and smooth. You got to apply some pressure. But it's not really the number of times, it's if the quality of the times that you go against the metal, and then you get a really good file. Let's say that you have your bracelet and it's already domed and you're ready to start putting it together, and you realize that you didn't punch a hole in where you needed it to go, but you've already textured it, you've already domed it, you've gone past all of these stages. If you're using one of the handheld hole punching devices, either the double hole punch or the handheld punch, you can still go in because this is such a slight dome here and you're at the edge, and you can still go in and punch your hole as you know where you need it. You could also take it back apart if it does flatten it some, and punch your hole and then use your bracelet bending plier again. Metal is very, very forgiving, and it will do just about anything you ask it to do. So don't be afraid to go back in, reposition it, redome it, work with it. It's very, very forgiving. Well, we're all done here, and I want to thank you for joining us today for this class, and I look forward to seeing you the next time.